Hello there, and welcome to the first tutorial on development with Unity. This is Opentibia project, and I'm Slavi. We're gonna talk about the UI and some problems that we face regularly in the UI development. So, without further introduction, let's get started. To get started with the UI, we need two main elements, canvas and event system. To create a canvas, we head to the create menu, UI and canvas. You can notice it automatically creates the event system. The canvas is responsible for containing UI elements, while the event system is responsible for handling events such as clicking, hovering, focusing and so on. In the introduction of the video, we had a background. This background is simply an image. To create an image the same way as we created canvas, right-click the canvas, UI, image. Now, we need to stretch this image to the background of the canvas. To do that, in the rect transfer component, click on the anchors. Now, press Alt in your keyboard and select which one of them we need. Actually, we need to stretch it, so we will select it. Done. Now, we need to select the image to show. Let's firstly make sure that the color is fully transparent and good to go. Now, the sprite, artwork, and we are done. But, now we have one problem. If we have a resolution of the screen that is not compatible with this background, it will look horrible. Now, to resolve this, we need aspect ratio. So, here, look like I have already searched for it. So, yes, it's the aspect ratio feather. Now, we need to envelop parent, and you can look at that in the documentation, and you will notice how it works. Now, wherever we go, it will simply remain the same as you go. You can also do fading parent, but if the screen resolution is not the same as the background, it will not stretch to the rest of the background. As you can see, there are here some gap and some gap here. Now, let's turn it back to envelope parent. Now, let's rename this to the background image. Okay. So, now we are ready to create windows, interfaces, and so on. So, to do that, I have already prepared some UI elements, or we'll say prefabs, containing some basic elements. Let's go with a window element. This creates a headless window, and this one is used in the login window. I don't know any other use for it, but it's used already. So, this is as simple as this. We can resize it, we can move it, and we can add a text to it. To add a text, we need to use the text mesh pro label, and this is also a prepared for this purpose. Here we can change the text. Let's say, for example, like if we are designing the login window account name, and we need to anchor this to the top so that we get full benefits. There are things you may need to understand about the pivots. The pivot is where the center of the image is located. We can set to 0 and 1 and then set this to 0 and 0, which makes it anchored to the top and the left. Now, to resize it, for example, to add a padding to it, we need to add something like 10 and this mob bit here and negative 10 in the y axis to make it go 1000. And this is how it works. Now, let's resize it, and you can notice it's stretched or was it anchored to the top and left. Now, the same way, we can create the password label, and let's just duplicate it using Ctrl D on the hierarchy and name this to password label, and here to account name label. Same way, we can, this is, let's use my magic numbers, 40, and rename it to password, and we are done. Now let's like widen this bit and center it. Now we need something like the input field. Already have some prefabs for it. This is the Text Mesh Pro input field, and we can rename it to account name input. Let's give it a try. And here in the Text Mesh Pro input field, let's write a text saying, for example, account name. We have a problem here. The text is not in a content type of password. So to do that, we can here in the content type, it changes to password. And you can see now the asterisk being rendered correctly. Also, we need to do the same thing that we just did with the labels. Sorry, I'm flickering. With labels, which is join the positions. And it seems like it's done already. This is one for the top, sorry, for the right, and one for the top. And we are good to go. You can notice this is a pivot we are talking about here. You can notice the pivot is here, and the pivot is here. If you have noticed why it's 1 and 1 here and why it's 0 and 1 here, this means that this point is actually the origin point. And this indicates the rest of the anchors. We can pivot it to the bottom and left, same for bottom right, and so on. So let's duplicate that and create and rename it to the password input. I think the code size is 105. This is how I rendered it, sorry. So 105 here, the same and the label, and we are good to go. You can notice something. Those yellow lines are the navigation. Those navigation, I don't know what they call them. The navigations are used to navigate between text field, input field, or buttons, and so on. Every selectable in the UI can be navigated to. We can disable this navigation by setting navigation to none, and it will not navigate to any element. We can use this navigation in the login window when the user presses tab, and it should navigate from the account name input field to the password input field. And I think I would feel better if this is 120 and this one's size 10. Okay, that feels good. Perfect. Now we can see this is also working perfectly with this. Now we need the pattern. Also, we have a button here that we can put as well, and let's name it to login button. Let's anchor this as a test before I do it. What is the correct pivot if I want to pivot it to the bottom right? Actually, we can achieve in it. Let's look here. Zero indicates here at the left. And 1 indicates the top. Here, 1 indicates the right, and 1 indicates the top. So, if we want to indicate the right, then we use 1. If we want to indicate the bottom, we use 0. Let's now reset this. Do not worry. Yeah. I did this. Also chain the anchors after chain the pivot. One tutorial or actually said one tip is using this, the real edit mode, the raw edit mode. This says when enabled, anchor values will not counter in size of the rectangle in order place. I feel like something is missing. I think this will change the position no matter of the anchor itself. So let's talk about that later. Anyways, Now we have this button and it's pretty much pixel. It's resized to like 80 had and 20. Now let's add a text. Again, we will use a text mesh pro label and put it into the login button. Now let's expand it to the side of the button using anchor and pivot. One thing in buttons that I actually see is that buttons are text are centered, and this is good. Also, the size is a bit of lower, like 9 or so. And let's name this to login. Okay, so now we need to make this button a bit of high. Firstly, let's make this negative 10. I have selected the label itself, that's why it went a bit of left. So the position x to negative 10 and the position y to 10 to raise it a bit up. And let's resize this to a bit like that and let's make it correct a bit. That looks good and that looks better. Awesome. One thing that we forgot is resetting this text. Okay, there's an additional input to this, which is the placeholder. We can say something like enter account name here as well. Select the text area and placeholder enter password. These are already prepared and you can freely use them. And it's all good. So we have created a login window design. This is fast and it's easy. You can expand this by adding your own authenticator or whatever elements you want, such as the TB itself. It added something like a lost password, manage account, or whatever. You can add anything you want in this. So we have created the login window, and now after we click login using some component that we need to create later, we will view some pop-up window to show like a title and a message and some buttons like okay, cancel, and so on. That was it for the first tutorial. I'll see you in the next tutorial, and thanks for watching this.